Hello everybody, this is Roger Hanson, welcoming you back to the strange, the bizarre, the unusual. I like it. Tonight, we are happy to present to you our ghost story. I'm also going to forego my usual introductory statement because of the length of the stories that are going to be told. Now, before we get started, I do want to say that even if the story is over 15 minutes long, we will not leave you hanging. There will be another video to continue the story at a later time. So, don't worry, we're not going to leave you hanging, like I said. And we hope that you enjoyed the story. If you want to leave a comment, please feel free to do so. We also ask that you like, subscribe, and share if you could. Thank you. Now on to the story. This is the Dybbuk Box. Here is the story of the haunted wine box, exactly as it appeared on eBay. You form your own opinion. The first buyer, an antique buyer, refinisher. Quotes: all of the events that I am about to set forth in this listing are accurate and may be verified by the winning bidder with the copies of hospital records and sworn affidavits that I am including as part of the sale of the cabin. During September of 2001, I attended an estate sale in Portland, Oregon. The items liquidated at this sale were from the estate of a woman who had passed away at the age of 103. A granddaughter of the woman told me that her grandmother had been born in Poland, where she grew up and married, raised a family, and lived until she was sent to a Nazi concentration camp during World War II. She was the only member of her family who survived the camp. Her parents, brothers, and sisters, husband, and two sons and a daughter were all killed. She survived the camps by escaping with some other prisoners and somehow making her way to Spain, where she lived until the end of the war. I was told that she acquired the small wine cabinet listed here in Spain, and it was one of only three things that she brought with her when she immigrated to the United States. The other two items were a steamer trunk and a sewing box. I purchased the wine cabinet along with the sewing box and some other furniture at the estate sale. After the sale, I was approached by the woman's granddaughter, who said, "I see you got the Dybbuk box." She was referring to the wine cabinet. I asked her what a Dybbuk box was, and she told me that growing up, her grandmother always kept the wine cabinet in her swing room. It was always shut and set in a place that was out of reach. The grandmother always called it the Dybbuk box. When the girl asked her grandmother what was inside, her grandmother spit three times through her fingers and said, "A Dybbuk and Kusslum." The grandmother went on to tell the girl that the wine box was never ever to be opened. The granddaughter told me that her grandmother had asked that the box be buried with her. However, as such a request was contrary to the rules of an Orthodox Jewish burial, the grandmother's request had not been honored. I asked the granddaughter what a Dybbuk and Kusslum were, but she did not know. I asked if she would like to open it with me. She did not want to open it, as her grandmother had been very emphatic and serious when she instructed her not to do so, and regardless of the reason, she wanted to honor her grandmother's request. I finally ended up offering to let her keep what seemed to me to be sentimental keepsake. At that point, she was very insistent and said, "No, no, you bought it." I explained that I didn't want my money back and that it would make me feel better to do what I thought was an act of kindness. She then became somewhat upset. Looking back now, the way she became upset was just plain odd. She raised her voice to me and said, "You bought it. You made a deal." When I tried to speak, she yelled she didn't want it. She began to cry, asked me to leave, and quickly walked away. I wrote the whole episode off to the stress and grief she must have experienced. I took my purchase and politely left. At the time when I bought the cabinet, I owned a small furniture furnishing business. I took the cabinet to my store and I put it in my basement workshop where I intended to refinish it and give it as a gift to my mother. I didn't think anything more about it. I opened my shop for the day and went to run some errands, leaving the young woman who did sales for me in charge. After about an hour, I got a call on my cell phone. The call was from my salesman. She was absolutely hysterical and screaming that someone was in my workshop breaking glass and swearing. Furthermore, the intruder had locked the iron security gates and the emergency exit and she couldn't get out. As I told her to call the police, my cell phone battery went dead. I hit speeds of 100 miles per hour getting back to the shop. When I arrived, I found the gates locked. I went inside and found my employee on the floor in my office sobbing hysterically. I ran to the basement and went downstairs. At the bottom of the stairs, I was hit by an overpowering, unmistakable odor of cat urine, where there had never been any animals kept or found in my shop. The lights didn't work. As I investigated, I found that the reason the lights didn't work also explained the sound of glass breaking. All of the light bulbs in the basement were broken. All 9 incandescent bulbs had been broken in their sockets, and 10 4-foot fluorescents were lying shattered on the floor. I did not find any intruder. However, I should also add that there was only one entrance to the basement. It would have been impossible for anyone to leave without meeting me head on. I went back up to speak with my salesperson, but she had left. She never returned to work, having been with me for 2 years. She refuses to discuss the incident to this day. I never thought of relating the event of that day to anything having to do with the cabinet. Then things got worse. As I already indicated, I decided to give the cabinet to my mother as a birthday gift. About 2 weeks after I made the purchase, I decided to get started refinishing it. I was surprised to find that the cabinet has a unique little mechanism. When you open one of the doors, the mechanism causes the opposite door and the little drawer below to open at the same time. It is very well made inside the cabinet. I found the following items. 1. 1928 U.S. wheat penny. 1. 1925 U.S. wheat penny. 1 small lock of blonde hair bound with string, one small lock of black brown hair bound with string, one small granite statue engraved and gilded with Hebrew letters. I have been told that the letters spell out the word shalom. One dried roseberry, one golden wine cup, one very strange black cast iron candlestick holder with octopus legs. I saved all of the items in a box intended to return them to the estate. The family has refused the items, so they will be included in this cell of the cabinet. After opening the cabinet, I decided not to refinish. I cleaned it and rubbed in some lemon oil. It was at this time that I noticed that there was an inscription in Hebrew carved into the back of the cabinet. I have no idea what it says or if it is significant. I have included a picture of the inscription below. On my mother's birthday, October the 28th, 2001, my mother called to me that she was going out of town with my sister for 3 days, and we postponed celebrating her birthday together until she returned on October the 31st, 2001. My mother came to my shop. We were going to have lunch together, but before we were going to leave, I gave her the wine cabinet. She seemed to like it. While she examined it, I went to make a phone call. I hadn't been out of sight more than 5 minutes when one of my employees came running into my office saying that something was wrong with my mom. When I went back to see what the matter was, I found my mom sitting in the chair beside the cabinet. Her face had no expression, but tears were streaming down her cheek. No matter how I tried to get her to respond, she would not. She could not. It turns out that my mother had suffered a stroke. She was taken to the hospital by ambulance. She ended up suffering partial paralysis and losing her ability to speak and form words. She has since regained the ability to speak. She could understand things being said to her and could respond by pointing it to letters on the alphabet to spell out words she wanted to say. When I asked her the following day how she was doing, she teared up and spelled out the word N-O-G-I-F-T. I assured her that I had given her a gift for her birthday, thinking that she didn't remember. But she became even more upset and spelled out the word H-A-T-E-G-I-F-T.